If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice at the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker.
Welcome, everybody. We are back. Thankful for the Day podcast brought to you from Bloomington, Indiana. I am Michael Doering. This is the podcast. We're going to start today. We're going to talk about my walks in the pasture and briefly, hopefully, go through that time frame. Before we do that, again, trying to make this a little interactive, and so we have included some scripture on the board. This is a JT thing. He has done this, and so I have not investigated. But what we are looking for is some interaction, trying to provoke our community to be more engaging with us. And so based on the scripture and the verses that you see up there, can you identify a theme? If you can, please share that with us. Toss it down in the comments for us, okay? And we are going to send out some swag, assuming that maybe you don't have some of that already. I think we can get our hands on some decals. We still do have a few bracelets left over. Unfortunately, I think we've ran through all of our shirts, so I can't offer that. Maybe you just need a hug. You know, I can give those out pretty freely. Sarah knows I do that frequently, so it doesn't create any havoc on the homestead. But yeah, let us know what you think. See if you can find the theme there in the verses that have been listed. According to JT's daughter, aka Threes, she was able to make a connection kind of effortlessly. Obviously required a little bit of effort, but not a huge amount. Also, we're going to try to stay to the shorter version format. I know that we think that that seems to be working a little better. Also, with that, you might have seen, we have moved. JT has worked incredibly hard on getting our website up. We've talked for a while about getting moved over to the Spotify world so that people don't have to have the video pulled up and have to be on YouTube. And in order for us to do that, we had to have a website and we had to have some of these other things in place. And so JT has been working for probably the last 2 to 3 weeks, if not maybe four, on creating a website that is not just, you know, some, sticks and mud, if you will, but something that has some structure that people can navigate, that has content that is desirable and also goes along with what we are doing. And so through his efforts of that website, we now are able to offer our podcast via Spotify and, I believe, Amazon Music. Is that correct? So that's really exciting for us. It's a huge win for us as a podcast. I know that he's put a lot of work into it. I don't know how much work, but I know it's been a lot. I know that he has invested a lot of his own time to get the website up so that we can even do this. And so we're still working through some hiccups, if you will, with Spotify. You have to download to one account an app, and then you have to upload from that account to Spotify. So we're still figuring out some of those hoops. But tonight we searched. We went on Spotify. We searched Thankful for the Day podcast, and sure enough, there was our podcast. And so we are up. We are active. We are currently trying to upload all of the episodes to Spotify as well as Amazon Music. And so it's really exciting. And again, for a couple guys from Ellettsville, Indiana that, you know, just a few months ago didn't even know if a podcast was really a real thing for us to do, to think that we've been able to formulate and scheme and make this happen is pretty remarkable. And I think a testament to, you know, when you're motivated to do something and you're driven and you feel a purpose behind it, you'll figure it out, even if you have to go through some growing pains and some bumps in the road. So please continue to support us, like, share, comment, and just spread the word. We are reminded, I'm reminded almost daily of how this podcast is impactful for people that have cancer, people that don't have cancer, family and friends of people that have cancer. And again, our whole thing, the reason that we wanted to do this is because we felt like through the telling of this story, we could resonate with a lot of people and hopefully spread awareness, information, and things that are helping us cope, adjust, and get through and strive through this. And so there is our little plug for Spotify and Amazon Music. We're going to hop right in to the pasture. I think where we finished up last, once we got through the surprise of the Deborah Hubbard episodes, as well as our nutrition, we had finished with, we had talked a lot about baseball season and then graduation. And we got into graduation a little bit. There's possibly an opportunity to talk short version maybe soon about graduation parties. We were invited to a lot of those and were able to celebrate with a lot of young humans that we know and love. And it was also a very weird, wonky time for us in that time too, as we were starting to eat, but not really being able to fully go that route. And so it's led us to the end of May. We've started to creep into June. And as we started to make our way into June, I was in the middle of doing some things that were brand new to me. One of those was Reiki therapy. Reiki therapy is essentially a grounding technique and a form, if you will, probably considered meditation-like. But it focuses on, one, you stopping and being in a place of stillness for as short of a time as you need, but as long as of a time as you want. And so essentially there are 10 placements that you place your hands and you stop for, I believe what they recommend is a minute. And while your hands are placed in these different places throughout your body, you are taking that minute to, one, be outside, absorb some vitamin D. All right, so Reiki talks about hand placements, being mindful, being outside. It's a big push on kind of connecting with nature, walking through the grass with your bare feet, allowing nature to kind of come into your world, allowing sunlight to hit your body. You know, obviously nobody's walking around naked, but if you can take a shirt off or if you can have more of your skin exposed, and again, disclaimer here, we don't want anybody getting sunburnt or anything like that, but it's basically about stopping your world for a 10 to 15 minute window and trying to just literally be in the moment of wherever you're at. And if that's along a nature trail or it's in where it was for me was on my basketball court, on the basketball court we have at the house, up by the barn. And I would do it early in the mornings and it would allow me to kind of set my day. Each position you're at for, I was working at a minute. And so I would hold that position for a minute. I would close my eyes. Most of the time it began with the prayer. A lot of my prayers at that time were specific to God healing me, me not accepting cancer, me telling cancer that it was not welcome, that it did not have authority in my body, that God did, you know, that I believed I was here for a greater purpose, that fear is a liar, devil is a liar. And he is just essentially trying to manipulate my fear and get me to give in to him. And so, but also then specifically, as you move through these different variations of the hand placements, you are also, one was on the top of the head, one was the eyes, one was the throat. Then you move down through your sternum, which was very fitting for me because that is where a lot of the lymphatic reaction that I had had with the spread of my cancer was. And, you know, then you move to your hips, you move to your back, down to your feet. And so I remember when I would get to my feet, my prayer for that minute basically was, God, just please continue to heal me and bless me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. And Reiki, I think, was a very important part of my process in healing and kind of coming to terms with everything. I did that daily for weeks. And in hindsight, I'm a little disappointed and frustrated with myself that I've gotten out of that habit. I've allowed life and work to become busy for me again, and have lost some of that. And so maybe this is a reminder for me that I need to be more in tune with that and find the time. Doesn't have to be in the morning. The whole idea is that you find the time to give yourself 10 to 15 minutes of this. And if you stop for 10 or 15 minutes and you take the phone away and you are disconnected from TVs and computers and internet and Wi-Fis and access points and all the stuff that we have beeping and clinging at us, how fulfilling that is from the inside out. And so I'm going through this Reiki. And after Reiki, because my doctor was encouraging me, one, to get exercise, but to also be outdoors and to get my breath going a little bit. It's the fine line of, we need you to exercise, but we don't want you to exercise too much because, one, you have cancer, which I don't have cancer, I just had cancer in me. Two, you are now having chemo dumped into your body, and now you're being placed on blood pressure medicine and heart medicine because of all these effects from the chemo. So we want you to exercise, but you can't get your heart rate too much. And a lot of the reading I was doing was, you know, connecting with nature, connecting with the earth, trying to be more natural. And so I would get done with Reiki. Usually I would try to do that with my shirt off, again, to just try to absorb as much of that vitamin D as I could and just the wind and earth. And I would typically end that with a walk. And my walks involved me shoeless, and I would walk horizontally in our field. And, you know, we've got a few acres there, and so I could walk from one of our tree lines across the field, which butts up to the start of a neighborhood. And I don't know, if I had to take a guess right now, I would say that's the equivalent of about a football field. Probably close to 100 yards, maybe a little bit more. And I would just walk back and forth and would sometimes try to do it briskly. Other times I would just walk. And, you know, again, sometimes shirtless, trying to soak in some of that vitamin D. Every time, well, not every time, most of the time it was shoeless and sockless. Again, just trying to feel, just trying to connect, just trying to be in the moment and to slow down. And during these walks is when I started to have some pretty, what I would say, aggressive conversations with God. And a lot of those conversations revolved around some self-pity. Why me? What the hell? Why is my family going to have to endure this? It's not fair that my sons are going to lose their father. It's not fair that my wife is going to lose her husband. It's not fair that I'm going to lose those relationships. It's not fair for my mom or my dad. It's not fair for my family, et cetera, right? So there was some self-pity. At times, probably more than I would even care to admit, but it is what it is. And some of those then morphed into just conversations and questions. Okay, Why me? Why this? Okay, God, I've known about you for a long time, again, and I think I've shared this. Both of my parents, my stepmother, were believers. God has been in my life for a long time in some form or fashion. When I was little, I was going to church every Sunday that I was with Jim and Marty. I was going through confirmation classes with my brothers. I was confirmed. I've been baptized. Those were all things that were a part of my upbringing. And I distinctly remember a story that was shared many times over about, you know, when Jesus roamed the earth as a human and how he would show up to these places and people would come out of the woodwork to be around him, to be blessed by him, to be healed by him, to be cured by him. And, you know, the one story that always stood out to me was the, and I don't know, and maybe somebody can comment on this in our section, in our comment section, where Jesus was at the time, but he had shown up to a gathering. Or actually, I think he was the gathering. He showed up, and then a gathering happened, and he was blessing people. And a lady who had been sick for many, many years heard of this and so believed in the power that he has that she didn't make her way to the front to be anointed in front of everybody. But she thought, man, if I can just get close enough to him, and if I can just brush his cloak, I know that I'll be healed. And so that story had always stood out to me. And that is ultimately where I started going with my conversations. As I'm telling him during my Reiki, I'm praying and I'm, you know, saying that God has authority and Jesus Christ has authority and the devil does not and cancer does not and fear does not. And then I start to ask and I start to say things like, God, I know you can heal because I've seen miracles happen. I've heard from other people that have seen miracles happen. But will you provide a miracle? And so that kind of became the reoccurring theme during my walks in the pasture. And on June 3rd, and we've got the journal here, and I think 2 weeks ago, JT and I were hem-hawing back and forth about, you know, when did that night happen? And for some reason, we were kind of stuck in April and May, and I'm flipping through the journal, and we can't find it, and we can't find it. And then tonight, and we don't usually think these things too far ahead. We try to come up with the topic here in the moment and then try to deliver that to you in a raw, uncut version so that you're getting an unfiltered, sometimes, unfortunately, unthought out version of what we're doing, and it leads me to ramble, etc. So tonight, you know, hey, what do you want to do? What are you thinking? I said, I don't know, man. Might be a good time to talk about the pasture. And he's like, oh, the pasture. Yeah, okay. And as I open up my journal, I open it up, and I let it fall open, and it falls open to June 3rd. And so, you know, we're close to a year anniversary from that day. It's May. We try not to give too many of those clues, but it's May. Is that right? It is May, right? Yeah, it's May. So June 3rd, 2022 is a Friday. And here's some of the cool things that happened on that day. Took my medicine in the morning. I got to go to school that day at Edgewood to help with the graduation lunch. I volunteered. That was a really good day for me and my soul. That was one, my son's graduation walkthrough. But when I had left in April, I hadn't seen a lot of those kids since I've left and since my diagnosis. And I was skinny and I was bald and I was in the midst of chemo, and chemo was kicking my ass. Whew. So I put school at 10 to help with grad lunch, and I got to see a lot of kids I love. And I put 3 exclamation marks there. And if you were one of those kids, if I helped you that day, I hope you understand how much that you helped me that day. So I left there feeling like I was on top of the world. But I had a couple Kate Farms that day. I had 4 Kate Farms that day. That was what I ate that day. But I went to work for an hour or two, came home, I mowed, Abby stopped by, Sarah met with, our friend Amy, Abby stopped by later on, and her and Sarah, got to spend some time together. And then I put in here JT and Threes, which is Threes is AKA Shayla Chambers. Her basketball number is Threes. It was 33. And so I would refer to her very affectionately a lot of the times as Threes. And so I put in here, JT and Threes stopped by. Good talk on the basketball court. And so I finished the day with that day. I said I almost got a headache, and that caused me to not eat. And I said I didn't try to eat, maybe tomorrow. And so it's also crazy to kind of read that, knowing where we're at in the process now. I'm a human vacuum and garbage disposal. Like, I cannot keep enough food around me. And like we talked about in the nutrition episode, it's the variation of food now is the difference. So anyway, the reason I specifically highlight the JT and the Threes stopping by is because, you know, we were up there talking, and Shay had become a very important young human in my life. She had been a part of my JAG program. And, you know, she, as most young humans are, is just dealing with a lot of stuff. School, graduating, sports, relationships, parents, jobs, all of those things that our 17 and 18 and 19-year-old young humans are dealing with that can be very overwhelming. And so it was just a good time for us to sit on the court. They just stopped by for no reason other than to just stop by and say hi and spread some love and basically to show up, I think, as JT had mentioned previously. And so, you know, we're up there talking. And at some point, Abby and Sarah had come out, and the dogs were running around, and the girls were being silly, and the three of us just kind of started talking and sharing on the basketball court. And I don't remember how the conversation got started, but, you know, we started talking about God and about just what's going on and where are you at and what are you thinking. And, you know, at this point, we're 3 months from diagnosis. I think approximately about 12 chemo treatments in, and, you know, still, as I said in that journal entry, not eating, relying on Kate Farm to provide my nutrition, and, you know, just trying to figure things out. And the conversation that, you know, JT and I had, and I would say, not to compare or to, but, you know, I think JT is in a different place in his spiritual journey and relationship than I am. And specifically at that time was in a different place. And if you want to say more mature or ahead of me, not that that's how we want to classify that, but maybe just a better understanding of things. And I really felt like, you know, I could bounce some ideas off of him and share some things with him, and he could provide me good feedback. And so as we're talking, And that actually leads me into another conversation that I'd had with Adam Yurgis, I think a few days before that. And Adam had picked me up, and we were going over to little grandma's house to look at some trees that she had fell that we needed to clean up for her. And as I'm explaining to Adam, he's, you know, man, how are you? Like, forget the bullshit. Like, how are you? Like, we've got 15 minutes here, man. Just talk to me. And I did. And I told him in that truck ride, I say truck ride because of the truck. I said, here's my worst case scenario, brother. And here's how I believe. The worst thing that happens to me is that I die and I get to go to heaven. That's the worst thing that happens. Now, I said the human side of that is I lose out on all these relationships and connections with people that I love, with other humans that I have claimed to be mine or to be a part of my life. And I'd be really, really sad for that. I said, but I'm not going to care about that stuff up there because you don't feel anguish. You don't feel anger. You don't feel anxiety. You don't feel stress or madness. You feel love and you feel joy and you feel contentment. And I said, so it's hard for me to explain that that's the worst case scenario because I love physically being here. And he got it and he understood. And it was just a moment for me to process. And so I'm kind of explaining that to JT, my worst case scenario. And, you know, we both kind of agreed like, listen, man, if that's your worst case scenario, sign me up. Yeah, and absolutely, absolutely, hands down, sign me up. Because when you get to heaven, you don't feel what you're missing. And months go by like blinks of an eye. And there's no missing that person. There's just excitement to see and meet that person again and to be able to embrace them again. And it's all of the good and none of the bad. And so, you know, we were kind of joking and talking and laughing and, you know, feeling, I think, pretty lighthearted, if you will, and if you can in that moment, about the worst case scenario. And I said, you know, here's the deal, man. And I shared the story about the lady showing up to where Jesus is, and the people gathering around him. And she so believed in his power that if all she could do, if all she could muster was to just simply brush his cloak, his cloth, she knew that would be enough to heal her of her afflictions. And I said, bro, I believe like that. Like, I've seen miracles happen. I've heard of miracles happening from people that I believe in. And I believe he is that powerful. I don't need him to place his hand on me. I don't need him to have this divine, bro, I just need to brush his cloak. And I said, I know he can save. I know he can do this, but will he? And that's the question I asked him. But will he? He, as I remember, it's a really good question, man. Do you have anybody that maybe you can talk to about that? I said, yeah. You know, how dare you ask me that question? Of course I have. There's numerous people that I can think of. I think the first two people that popped into my brain were my friend, my brother, Pastor Andy. And I think the very next person that popped into my brain was my friend, my brother, Dan Wall. And I said, yeah, man, I do, actually. Now that you say that, I do have somebody that I can talk to. And I think later that night, or even maybe just in a few moments later, we discussed like, okay, I'm going to reach out to Dan. And I Dan knew of JT, or JT knew of Dan, but they, you know, kids didn't cross paths, and, you know, Dan's got boys and JT's got girls, and so sports was like, they never had crossover like that. So I think they knew of each other, but there was no real intimate connection there. And I said, yeah, I think I need to reach out to Dan. And so that's probably a podcast on its own, because what started from that conversation was Dan and JT and I starting to meet. It started weekly, and now just because of life and everybody having commitments and schedules, we've converted it to a monthly, once a month kind of a thing. But that conversation on the basketball court on June 3rd led us to starting a small group, if you will, of the three of us, basically coming together to talk about life and all of the things that I mentioned young humans are dealing with that we all are still dealing with, even as old humans. And I think is a very great opportunity for us to segue into what will be our next podcast. And June very quickly turns into a month of joy and small victories and celebrations along our cancer journey. And so that's where we're going to leave that. I think the next episode, we're getting awful darn close to talking about the stranger and that visit. And so the question that I asked for weeks,
if you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles,
I know he can, but will he? Was absolutely it was absolutely answered, and it's answered, and you're seeing it because it's May of 2023 and October of 2022 has come and passed, and so I know he can, will he? And the answer is yes, he will, and he has. And he will again. And so we've got to be pretty close to our time frame. I think it's a great place for us to wrap up this episode. And so, again, keep in mind, if you've got any thoughts or ideas on the board behind us and what those verses might all have in common, please share that with us. We're gonna send you out some swag of some sort. We'll find something. Maybe we'll just give you a shout out on the next episode. I don't know. Whatever you want, let us know. And let's give a little plug for our next episode. And I think it's gonna be a really good opportunity for us to talk about the stranger and kind of what proceeds to happen for us in the journey after that June 3rd discussion with JT and Threes on our basketball court. As always, thank you so much for following along. We hope these shorter versions, as well as being able to hit you on Spotify and Amazon Music, is going to make it easier for you to follow along and to share our story with people. Again, I cannot ask you enough to please like, share, and comment, because we just absolutely feel like this message is supposed to be heard from two more people. And we're just, if there's five of us that listen, we accept that. But man, if we can get to 500 or 5,000 or gosh, that 5,000 seems like an absurd number. But please share and like. And again, if you've got feedback, if there's things that you would like to see us do, let us know. We'll think about it. We'll incorporate anything to try to get engagement from people, because that's what we want. We want people talking. We want people discussing. We want people to say, hey, I've heard this guy, and he's talking about this, and that might be able to help your mom or your dad or your brother or your sister. Okay? So thank you so much for being engaged with us. As always, be thankful for the day. We never know when our last one's going to be here, and so why not be thankful for the one that you're given? Follow along. We'll look forward to seeing you next week. We're out.